Hi, I'm Richard Burke, and today we'll be discussing our paper titled Accessing Secure Data on Android Through Application Analysis, which was co-authored by Dr. Nhien An Lekar. First, I will discuss the motivation behind our research and give a high-level overview of the Android security model. Next, we will talk about our literature survey concerning related work on data acquisition. Finally, we explain our proposed approach and experiment results. Mobile devices are an important source of information in most criminal cases, since they are completely integrated into our modern lives. Acquiring data from these devices can be difficult. We want to expand the toolkit of the average investigator by identifying the most viable acquisition technique after commercial tools fail. It would need to work in most situations and should not require highly specialized skills. We therefore performed an extensive literature survey and compared various acquisition methods. We validated our chosen technique through experimentation. Let's first have a look at the Android security model from a higher level. Each application is assigned a unique user ID at installation, and file access is controlled using regular Linux permissions, also called mandatory access controls. Finer-grained permissions are controlled by SA Linux, a kernel module which takes precedence over regular Linux permissions. The SA Linux implementation is also referred to as discretionary access controls. The Android runtime is used to communicate with the underlying system, such as the binder framework for inter-process communication. Android also supports use of the trusted execution environment. This is a CPU feature which can switch between the normal world, which holds the main operating system, and the secure world, which holds a secondary operating system, such as Android Trustee. The secure world is used to store sensitive data, such as encryption keys, while the CPU ensures data separation. Communication between worlds is handled by the secure monitor, which operates at the highest privilege level. Android also implements verified boot for checking integrity of files related to the boot sequence, full disk, and file-based encryption of non-volatile data, and can limit system calls per application by implementing seccomp filters. Our literature survey covered various papers focused on data acquisition techniques. We limited the scope of our survey to software acquisition methods only. Each method presents its own challenges. For example, binary exploitation requires intimate knowledge of the operating system and processor architecture, making it difficult to perform. Cold boot attacks require an unlocked bootloader, while methods for acquiring volatile memory may need elevated privileges or are device-specific because they rely on exploitation of proprietary protocols. We propose application analysis as the go-to method after commercial tools fail. It is relatively easy to perform by an average investigator, works cross-platform, and has the potential to identify or acquire information. We based our approach on the field of malware analysis, which specializes in the analysis of unknown malicious applications. The goal of our approach is to identify acquisition opportunities for an application of interest. An Android test device or emulator with root access is required for our method. Our approach is divided into four phases. First, we reset the state of our device. When using a physical device, we restore a backup created earlier. We then check the date and time settings to ensure that they are correct. Next, we install the target application and start capturing network traffic. This requires network interception with a self-signed CA certificate added to the Android certificate store. Network functions can also be hooked using FreeDA when the application implements certificate pinning or uses a protocol, such as HTTP2, which is not supported by the interception software. In phase 3, we interact with the target application to create artifacts of interest. Then we record changes made to the file system using standard Linux command line utilities. We stop capturing network traffic and acquire volatile memory. Finally, we copy all collected artifacts to our research machine. If we install the application for the first time from the Google Play Store, then we also copy the application's APK file. In the final phase, we decompile the application's APK file and use static analysis to correlate artifacts observed during dynamic analysis with the code. We created a checklist that can be used to identify relevant application behavior, such as encryption routines or use of the trusted execution environment. If we find any publicly exported activities or services, we can try to interact with them. We can also use Frida to hook or manipulate functions of interest to get a better understanding of how they work and to try and identify acquisition opportunities. The entire procedure can be repeated until all scenarios are covered and understood. For our experiment, we used the Samsung S7 Edge as a test device. The device was running Android version 8 with a custom recovery ROM from the Team Win Recovery project. We also enabled root access on the device for acquisition of volatile memory and for the use of software requiring elevated privileges. On the device itself, we used Frida for network interception and hooking functions of interest, while we used GDB server for remote debugging of processes. Volatile memory was acquired using the PM dump utility. The device was connected via Wi-Fi to a custom access point running on Ubuntu Linux. The host access point daemon was used to create a wireless access point, and IP tables from the NetFilter project provided routing. Interception of network traffic was enabled by using Burp Suite and Mitten Proxy and adding a trusted CA certificate to the Android certificate store. Acquired artifacts were copied to a local workstation for further analysis. We used the development branch of JEDEX for decompilation and static analysis. GDB was used for connecting with GDB server for remote debugging on the test device. Shell access from our workstation was provided by the Android debug bridge over USB. To validate our approach, we selected the top 3 secure notes application from the Google Play Store, based on the number of ratings, number of downloads, and position in the recommended list. The core functionality of all these applications is securely storing user data. The applications selected were SafeNotes, Private Notepad, and SecureNotes. Let's first discuss the summary of results. All applications use static passwords in some form or another. Acquisition from cloud storage was possible in 2 of the 3 applications analyzed. The SafeNotes application contained undocumented debug functionality, while the SecureNotes application used weak encryption and unencrypted communications. SafeNotes stores each user node in its application-specific shared preferences folder on internal storage. Each node and its metadata is stored in the JSON format. The application encrypts each node with 1 of 2 possible static keys. The key generation routine can be seen in the top figure. The actual contents of the node can be encrypted separately with a user-defined password. Nodes can also have different states. When a node is unlocked, the user is not required to enter their password to view its contents. Instead, the application stores the user password in the node file itself. When a node is locked, this password is removed from the file, requiring that the user enters it upon opening. Nodes created in the Android application can be synchronized with the protectedtext.com website or vice versa. The user can choose a random URL to store their node, but the website does not provide any form of authentication. Anyone who knows the chosen URL can download the encrypted node contents by adding the action is getJSON getParameter to the URL. An attacker can then perform an offline brute force attack on the downloaded data to try and decrypt its contents. We created a proof of concept decryptor which executes a dictionary attack to guess the user password. It uses multi-threading for increased efficiency. The user has lost all control over their data once it is downloaded by an attacker. Although the user might have chosen a strong password, future technological and cryptographic advances might make decryption viable at a later time. SafeNodes also provides a mandatory PIN access control mechanism. However, when the PIN code 556711 is entered, a debug string is displayed. This string contains two groups of 3 bytes, which are part of the SHA-512 hash of the PIN code chosen by the user. The application checks if a user has entered the correct PIN code by checking if these two groups of bytes are present in the hash calculated over the entered PIN code. It provides a high probability for a hash collision, since the hash only has to partially match. Ironically, using a weaker hashing function, such as SHA-256 or SHA-128, will provide more protection, since it uses less bits. We have also observed that sometimes the same group of bytes is chosen twice, requiring only one group of 3 bytes to be present in the hash. We created a proof of concept Python script which is able to crack most PIN codes in seconds. The output of our tool can be seen in the bottom figure. Private Notepad creates a random encryption key on first startup, which is stored in the file protected-notes-preferences.xml in its application-specific shared preferences folder on internal storage. The stored key is encrypted with a static key, which is comprised of 2-byte arrays that are combined by applying the exclusive OR operation on each byte in the array. This technique does not provide any security, since the key will be the same every time on any device. The Base46 encoded version of this key can be seen on this slide. As mentioned earlier, every application that we analyzed used some form of static encryption key, which is interesting since Android provides secure storage in the trusted execution environment through the KeyStore API. Android also provides extensive documentation on its proper usage. Just like SafeNodes, the private Notepad application also provides synchronization with the cloud. The application uses Google Remote Procedure calls over HTTP2 to communicate with a Google Firebase backend. Network traffic could only be intercepted using function hooking with Frida because our interception software did not support HTTP2. We established that the contents of the nodes are decrypted before being synchronized with the server. This means that the developer of the application should have access to this data, even if it is encrypted server-side at a later time. A mutual legal assistance treaty, or MLAT, might prove a viable option for data acquisition in this specific case. All 3 applications advertise using AES symmetric encryption. However, the Secure Notes application actually uses the DES algorithm, which has been considered broken since 1999. It is unclear why the developer chose to implement this algorithm. Using AES only requires changing the requested cipher instance. It also encrypts user data with the static password Kalanda Kalanda. This information is stored in an external storage location accessible by the user. Secure Notes therefore provides the least security from all analyzed applications. Secure Notes also features cloud synchronization. However, this functionality was not operational at the time of testing. The application uses unencrypted communications, making data acquisition trivial. The application uploads unencrypted user data on startup even when the user has not enabled the synchronization feature. Since no user identifier is specified, there is no way to correlate user data with a specific account. Secure Notes also provides a password recovery feature, which sends the user password to a predefined email address using unencrypted communications. Our research has shown that application developers are not very security aware. Advanced security features, such as storing sensitive information in a trusted execution environment, seems to be rarely implemented. In all cases, we were able to identify opportunities for data acquisition, either local or remote. Application analysis is therefore a valid approach, which can be applied to every Android device. It does come with some disadvantages. It only provides data acquisition limited to the scope of the target application. Access to the application is often needed, requiring cooperation from the suspect or a bypass for built-in Android access controls. However, it can still provide useful results, as demonstrated. Thank you for your time listening to our talk. We are happy to answer any questions you might have.